Hello, Airbus Cockpit Coach here. You're joining me in the Fenix A320, and in this video we're going to look at pilot waypoints. So what exactly are pilot waypoints? Let's jump in and have a look. Before we do so, don't forget to hit that thumbs up button and give the video a like. So pilot waypoints can be found in the data page of our MCDUs. They're on page 2, so we hit the data page and we scroll across. We're on page 2 of 2 up here. And you'll see up here pilot waypoints in the top right. So let's click on that. So line select against that in the top right. So pilot waypoints are essentially user defined waypoints. So we can put a waypoint essentially anywhere on the map that isn't currently in the database. There are three ways of doing that. So we can use either latitude or longitude. We can use place bearing and distance. We can use place bearing. Most commonly it's place bearing distance that's used at the middle one there. Latitude and longitude is used more in oceanic operations. The bottom one is not very often used. It's not something I would use during the course of general flying across Europe. So we can put a waypoint essentially anywhere on the map. So let's take the most commonly used option here, which is the middle one, place bearing and distance. Let's have a look at our navigation display. We're currently on our way up to Edinburgh from London Luton. And let's say we wanted to avoid, let's say, some weather here, or whatever reason we want to put a waypoint out here. The place has to be something that's in our navigation database already, so an airport, a waypoint, a VOR. As long as it's in the database, we can use it, or it can be another pilot-entered waypoint as well. So let's take Airbus. First of all, we need to call this something, so let's call it Airbus. Is our name. Airbus is place reference, so what we're using as our initial starting point. And we put forward slash, let's come off on a bearing of 300 from Airbus. And then we want a distance, so let's put something 10 miles out. Put that in there, and we store that. Now you see it's not in there. So the reason for that is because we have not selected that waypoint into our flight plan. We come into our flight plan and we put Airbus in after Airbus. There we go, execute that. You can see that is now entered into the flight plan. And we can fly to that. We can do anything we would normally would do with any other waypoint. So we can put in speed constraints and altitude constraints against it, step altitudes. We can now use our Airbus waypoint and we can put another waypoint in after that. So if we put in a name which the flight plan doesn't recognize, if we enter that, the database takes us back to our new waypoint page because it says, well, tell me where Airbus 2 is because it's not in my database currently. So Airbus 2 is going to be off Airbus, again on a 300 radial at 10 miles. And we can store that. And then we simply go and enter that. Into there, does that look sensible? That's what we described. Get the discontinuity out. So there we go, we're now tracking to our own waypoints, Airbus and Airbus 2. Before continuing on our original course. The most common use for these are in the secondary flight plan. So we can set up emergency turns on departure and takeoff for terrain avoidance. So we can plan for that already. And we can also put in points just for, let's say we're descending into an airport and 30 miles from the airport we wanted to be at a particular altitude, but that isn't on our route currently. We can put a waypoint in and then we can put a restriction against that. So let's say 20 miles from Trent on track 342. New waypoint, and we'll call this one Airbus 3. So VOR, so place was Trent, Tango November Tango. Three, four, three. 20 miles. Select the VOR as the reference and store that. And we can now use that, and we could, for example, put that into the flight plan. Airbus 3, after Trent. Insert. And then we can clear out that discontinuity. And let's say there was a particular altitude we wanted to be at that particular location. We can go across, right select, and put an altitude constraint. So we're still in the climb. Let's say we wanted to be 360 there, which is our cruise climb. So we now entered a hard restraint at that point, and that may help with our vertical navigation. Probably more useful on descent, getting to make sure you're at the correct altitude when arriving at an aerodrome, and your descent is nice and planned and continuous, making sure you're not too high on arrival. So all these waypoints we put in, they get stored. So if we come back into the data page, our pilot waypoints here, they're all stored in there. We can just delete them all out. If we delete them all, it shouldn't do, because they were being used by the flight plan. Those that are being currently used should not delete. So we do that, select that. Yeah, pilot element retained. So we're using Airbus 3 at the moment, so Airbus 3 is retained. The other two were passed, they've gone out. So you can delete those, or to delete anything that you're using, you come back into the flight plan and you delete it out of there by going clear and left line select against that. Place bearing is an interesting one, something we use for the private pilot's license when I'm teaching. That we've constantly got student pilots drawing radials off two different VORs, seeing where they cross and identifying their location. So to input these, we can look at a couple of fixes here. So Coal Hill, we could do a line out at 020, with no gap, perhaps 120. So we put EOL for Pole Hill, 020, and OGAP that's 120, and put that in. We need to give it a name, so we can call it Airbus 4, store that. But if we come back into the flight plan, Airbus 4 in, where are we currently? So after Nelsa, let's go to Airbus 4. See what that looks like, yep. So insert. This is where the 120 radial from GAB intercepts the 020 radial from Pole Hill. It's not something I would use flying commercially in controlled airspace within Europe, but just letting you know that's there as a feature. Obviously latitude and longitude, you just enter. Again, useful for oceanic. You can also bring these waypoints into the FIX info side, so we can go, we can put Airbus 4 in. It knows where that is. So if we deleted Airbus 4 from the flight plan now, clear that out, insert, you see we're now using the pilot waypoint as a FIX info reference. So it will display there just for purpose. So we could use this to perhaps mark a boundary of high terrain to one side. We don't want to go any further over than that. As one example on a particular approach, so we can use it to mark certain things, and then we can draw radiuses around Airbus 4, for example, using it as we would in the FIX info page, which I have a separate video on. Or we can draw radials off that as well. Let's say there was a danger area here, and we wanted to avoid that at a certain altitude, so if we were to descend we have to stay clear of it, for example. Just throwing out one possibility of what that could be used for. So you can use the pilot waypoints within the fix info side as well, which is handy. It's important when you start your flight that you're looking for stored pilot waypoints, making sure there's not a bank of things which are quite irrelevant to your flight from a previous flight. So it'd be normal practice just to delete those out and make sure there's nothing in there. So you can think of various situations where drawing a point on the navigation display for situational awareness can be useful, and there's different ways we can do that. Most commonly used for setting up our emergency turns on departure when we have an engine failure scenario. And that's when we're kind of using them on a day-to-day basis. I just thought I'd let you know that one's there and how to use it, and kind of a go at applying those to some of your individual circumstances you may come across. If you have any questions on that at all, please drop them in the comments below, and don't forget to hit that like and subscribe button to stay up to date with the latest content. I'll catch you on the next one. Thanks for watching.